Hey now, Rodney Erdickson here, and this is my first impression review of the SnowJoe 18-inch 12-amp electric snow thrower model SJ617E like Echo. Important to note, if the video that you were looking for involved seeing this electric snow thrower in action, that is to say displacing snow or even with the motor running, you'll have to watch another video. This video will be held indoors and I will not be starting the motor. Okay, that being said, let's begin with dimensions. Now, right now I constructed the unit at its highest point. You can construct it so that it is smaller. It is the handle doesn't raise as high, it's rather shorter, but right now I constructed it so that it is as far extended as it can. When it comes to height, the unit is around 39 inches high at its highest. When it comes to depth, it's around 40 inches deep at its furthest extension. And when it comes to width, you're gonna need around 19 and a half, 20 inches maximum. So as you can tell, the unit is not terribly large. Now, it came in a box that was rather compact. It came disassembled with some assembly required. We'll talk about this in a minute. As far as the box that the unit is shipped in, we're looking at around 18 inches high.
It's hard to do this when you got a flap.
And around 20 and a half inches depth. So overall the unit is quite portable, even in its box state. I ordered it on Walmart's website, and they included free shipping, over $50 spent, because the unit did not surpass their weight and or dimension limits for standard shipping. So that was good. When it comes to assembly, assembling the unit was rather easy and straightforward. So you had your base unit with this largest handle attached by a cable. Now this was just dangling, this wasn't attached. And you didn't have the hood and chute assembled, nor did you have the chute control and all of these, the minor handle, the mid handle, and the large handle. What was involved was assembling the chute, which is just the hood going onto the chute. Use these large thumb screws. The whole unit uses these large thumb screws and pins, or bolts if you will. The hood used the two smallest bolts. From there, the hood was placed on the bracket on the base. It snapped into place, and the one screw that is used on the entire unit was used here to bind the screw, the hood and chute to the base. When it came to that screw, keep in mind that the screw is a light duty screw, and in order to bore through this screw hole, it took a lot of effort, and because of that I stripped the screw, so keep that in mind. From there, what you had is you had three bars. You had, as I said, the small bar, the medium bar, and the large bar. The large bar is already attached to the unit but dangling because it's just attached by a cable. The small bar is inserted first. It is binded by these J hooks, and again you have these large thumb screws for the lowest bar. It slides into the forks and then is binded by the J screws. The thumb screws are on the inside for the lowest bar. For the medium and superior bar, These have your standard pins and the thumb screws on the exterior. Keep in mind that the standard pins have a square spacer between the head of the unit and the shaft, and the spacing on the tubes for the bars are squared, so you want to fit that squared spacer within the square in order to ensure that your bolt is held by these thumb screws in a tight manner and it won't cause flex. You don't want flex. Flex will cause undue strain on these bars. So yeah, small bar, medium bar, major bar. You had this I want to say shaft. It's not shaft. It's chute. Chute control bar, which came in two parts. You had the handle attached to this insert. You then had this extension, which with the sleeve and this thumb screw, or the screw, yeah, this thumb screw. You unscrewed a thumb screw. You introduce the handle through this rubberized spacer. It inserts within the sleeve. This, you then align the holes on this on this shaft with the holes in the spacer, and then you pass the thumb screw through and you tighten the thumb screw to hold it all in place. As far as the way this extension hooks into the port for the chute control, you have a cotter pin. You remove the cotter pin, you introduce the shaft into the hole. Again, you have to align the holes on the rod with the holes on the insert. You then pass the cotter through pin through and it holds the whole deal together. What you have is you also have these cable management hooks, which are on these brackets. They have an end that can be flexed as so. You pass the major cable that's going from the base of the unit to the controller switch on the major handle. As you can tell, I twisted the cable a bit around the bars to take away some of the slack and to prevent hang. Important to note, when I did so lightly, leaving enough slack at the connector at the base of the unit and enough slack at the connector at the controller box to ensure that it doesn't provide too much strain on those joints. I then, of course, binded the cable using those brackets. So, when it comes to performance, important to note, I am I come from experience using a gas thrower, and this unit is obviously not a gas thrower. It was much less expensive, but this might be a situation of you get what you pay for, because this unit is much lighter, which has its pros and its cons. Now, according to the instruction manual, the weight of this unit is 25.9 pounds, so 11.75 kilograms. For your information, since I have it here, what's important? Clearing width is 18 inch, 46 centimeters. Depth of snow cut is 8 inch, 20 centimeters. Throw distance max is 20 feet, 6 meters. Plowing capacity max is 16.5 tons an hour, 15 metric tons an hour. And the chute is 180 degrees adjustable. So, on that subject, when using the unit, first of all, the sound of the engine, if you thought that you'll be, or the sound of the motor, I should say, if you thought that you were able to use this unit at off hours, essentially when people are sleeping, thinking, oh, it won't make much noise, this unit is actually quite noisy. It's a different noise than a gas unit. This sounds more like a power tool, such as a drill or a saw that is not making contact with the surface. It is loud, it is rather high-pitched compared to a gas unit, which is more of a consistent bass tone. When it comes to the unit, as mentioned, it's quite light. Because of this, this has its advantages and disadvantages. Advantages being, as you could tell right now, I have it inside in my unfinished basement. Since my basement's unfinished, I'm not worried if snow and water drip off the unit onto the floor. I don't care. That's an advantage. Also, no nauseous fumes due to fuel or oil. No fluids to spill over, because again, it's an electric unit. Also, an advantage is no having to start and stop the motor. There's no idle of the motor. The motor's either on and working or off and not working. Essentially, the way that the motor is actioned and then killed is just with this controller box here. Essentially, what you do is you push the button, and while pushing the button, you pull on the trigger, and the motor will function until the lever is released, a safety mechanism. If you have noted, that the controller box is on the right side. That being said, for someone with disabilities who do not have the use of their right arm, this might be rather difficult. It would involve, I guess, sneaking in here, triggering the safety button, then pulling on the handle, and I guess pushing as so. I don't know. Not an issue I have to worry about for my usage of the unit, but something to keep in mind if you feel that a user of the unit might have issues with this. On the subject of the weight of the unit, as I've mentioned, light, easily transportable. Advantages. Disadvantages. Since the unit's so light, I found that the unit will have trouble scooping up snow at the base, picking it up and throwing it. Rather, what I've noted this unit does, since it's so light, is it will tend to climb on snow, which means that it takes multiple passes, minimally 2 to 3 passes, in order to clear an area. So you have to factor this in. Maybe it's lighter and that makes it easier to push than a gas unit, but add to the fact that you have to pass 2 to 3 times and all of a sudden you might be looking at the same amount of effort. Also, since the unit is so light, it's when trying to push it into snow, especially rather thick accumulations of snow, we're saying here a foot or 30 centimeters, what I've noted is that the unit not only will climb up onto the snow instead of getting underneath it and feeding it into the chute and then throwing it, but what it'll also do is, since it's so light, it'll tend to slide, to skate, if you will, over to the sides. So that adds to the frustration of trying to get under that snow and collecting the snow. Also, if your snow is an uneven surface due to freezing underneath, such as ridges or ice or what have you, this unit will not, again, scoop underneath and get all that stuff. Rather, it will climb over sideways and skid to the side, and it takes effort. Keep that in mind. As far as chute control works more or less all right. It's 180 degree chute, as you could tell. When it comes to the chute, unlike a pure gas, a gas powered unit, I should say, pardon me. What I've noted is that this chute will tend to not throw a steady stream. I mean, it throws a steady stream, more or less, but what it will also do is it'll also overflow and rather scatter snow all over the unit. Think of lava coming out of a volcano. So it's not a clean operation. You have your stream of snow, which is good, but you also have that overflow that goes all over the unit and obviously falls back on the surface of where you had just passed. So if you want a completely clean and perfect pass, don't expect it with this unit. Again, that might be an issue of you get what you pay for. When it comes to cable management, this having used exclusively gas throwers in the past, I've learned that one has to become accustomed to dealing with the cable when passing the unit. I've learned that it benefits me to pass the cable behind me so that when I'm pushing, I don't have to worry that I trip on the cable or pull out the cable, disconnect the cable, what have you. Also, fortunately, what they included was this cable management system, which works quite well. Essentially, what you do is you hook up your extension cord to this feed, and then what you do is with the extension cord, not with this, I'm just using this as an example, but what you do is with the extension cord, you create a loop with the extension cord, you pass your loop through this feed, as you can tell, and then you hook the loop on this tongue, you pull it tight, and what this should do is this should prevent the cable from becoming disconnected as you use the unit, and this tongue system works quite well. So that being said, as I've mentioned, the unit's light, it has its advantages for transportation, it has its disadvantages for getting under that snow and catching the snow and throwing it. What I noted is that also, since this is not a propelled unit, it has no propulsion, it's just a push unit, it takes a lot of effort in order to push this unit, especially through older snow or large accumulations of snow, in order for it to scoop up the snow and throw the snow. Also, interesting to note, this unit doesn't have cutter bars. Cutter bars are often included on gas units. They're quite useful. What they can do is, when you have side banks of snow, you could cut into the bank and cut out a groove, and that groove gets fed into the unit. The snow is then expelled through the chute. Since this unit doesn't have cutter bars, you have to rely on just the edge of the feed in order to catch the snow, and that works more or less well. I can tell you that that at least works a lot better than taking on snow, especially a considerable amount of snow, head on with the unit. The engine will force, it will slow down in those cases when it's taking on too much snow. It's a light duty unit, keep that in mind. This unit would most likely work best if one were to break up the snow with a shovel, essentially scatter the snow in a path, and then you take on the snow with this unit. Keep in mind that, again, due to cable management, it is probably a good idea when you use the unit to set forth a path that involves going forward and away from your cable source and not having to backtrack on your cable source. I found that when I was backing up or turning the unit around, I had to always be aware of where my cable was, not to catch the cable. Very important. Also, it is probably a good idea to spread out to lay out the cable, the extension cord, to the area that you want to pass, and then work your way from the cable and not keep your cable in a coil and try to move away from the coil. Coiled cables will often get caught on things, they'll often knot up and bunch up, and that involves situations where you have to stop the unit, undo the cable, and then get back to using the unit, which is costly when it comes to time. So yeah, I'm pretty sure that covers all the bases I wanted to discuss in this video. Again, this is an issue of you get what you pay for. If you were looking into this unit thinking that, oh well, this unit will make my life easier, as I've mentioned, the 2 to 3 passes it takes in order to clear an area, combined with the physical effort needed in order to push the unit into the snow, especially when the snow is difficult and this unit wants to either skate laterally or climb up on mountains instead of getting underneath and scooping up the unit, it's very demanding physically. don't think that this unit makes your life a breeze and easy, or snow clearing a breeze and easy. The one thing that this unit probably can do that will save you effort is if your main concern is the lifting and throwing of snow physically with a shovel, at least this can prevent, this can take take the effort out of the lifting and the tossing of the snow. But other than that, dealing with thick amounts of snow, dealing with older snow that has been sitting around for a couple of days to a couple of weeks, this unit is, it struggles. It's a light duty unit. Do I regret my purchase? No. Overall, in the lifting of the snow, I believe that this unit, the lifting and the throwing of the snow, this unit can help me. The only issue is the effort needed to bring the unit out, bring the unit back in, pass the extension cable, extend the extension cable, connect the extension cable, be aware of the extension cable. This unit doesn't make your life quicker, doesn't make your job quicker. It makes the lifting and throwing easier. That's about all. Other than that, you still need a shovel. You won't be able to use this unit without using a shovel. Then again, it should be noted that I used to have a push snow thrower like this, just obviously larger and gas. And for a gas unit, it's pretty much the same pitfalls and issues that you have. This unit is lighter, which is a great advantage, not to mention that no nauseous fumes, noxious liquids, such as fuel, carburant, gas, whatever you want to call it, nor oil in it, so that's good. All in all, I don't regret my purchase, but for those who want a one solution to handle all types of snow in all conditions and passing only one time, I recommend you at least get a propelled unit, not a unit you have to push yourself. And I don't know how expensive electric units fare, but I know I used to have an expensive gas unit, and you know, when it's propelled, it perhaps is a bit easier and isn't so much effort. But you know, considerations to keep in mind. So with that, I hope this information helps, and as usual, all the best.